Welcome, 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 geeks and nerds, girls and boys, to a brand new edition of Geeked Me Radio. Tonight we'll be talking with local writer, filmmaker Vanessa Roman about a brand new movie that she has out on streaming services called Doubting Tom. Later on we'll be talking with actor Sean Kanan about his upcoming role in Cobra Kai Season 5, his other various roles, his book that's out, and more. Stand by.
We're talking TV, comics and movies, and video games.
If you're driving around the greater St. Louis area tonight, hearing us on the Big 550 KTRS, hello to you. Thank you for tuning in. If you are streaming us out there on the KTRS app or on the website, hello to you. No video tonight, unfortunately. Joey V, my executive producer, has a well-deserved night off. He's having a long weekend down at the lake, and he's hopefully having some fun frolicking and staying out of the storms, and he'll be back next week. We'll have video once again then, but that's okay. For those of you who are hearing us after the fact in the podcast form, that makes no difference to you at all. So hello to you, and thank you for tuning in. Make sure, if you have not already done so, please leave us a 5-star review. That always helps us out in search engine optimization. And be sure to just visit the website, geektomeradio.com. If you haven't checked out an episode lately, maybe you missed last week with our composer from The Sandman, David Buckley, talking to him, or one of our other various interviews. We always like having people throughout the tandems of geekdom, be it the composers, writers, directors, like my friend Vanessa, who's in tonight. So make sure you go to geekedmeradio.com, check out the website, and check out some of the episodes you may have missed recently. That being said, as I alluded to, I've got a guest in studio live. Not often do I have them live. They're usually on the video screen or over the phone, so this is always fun. Local writer, filmmaker, director, producer as well. Is that one of the hats you'd say?
It is. Vanessa
Roman, how are you?
I am well. How are you, James?
Doing good. Thanks for coming in. It's always great to see you. It was, I guess, about a month ago I saw you last when we were filming out in DeSoto.
DeSoto, yeah.
So now, we were talking about Doubting Tom. This was, wasn't it 6 years ago that we did this? It doesn't seem like it was long ago, but am I correct?
Yeah, it was a while ago. It was pre-pandemic.
That's right, which is weird to think about now. Yeah, all the stuff that has gone on since then. But you obviously have been working on other projects since then. So we just talked about the one we were filming in DeSoto, which I won't get into too much of because I'm not sure how much you can talk about.
Well, you know, just a little. I mean, I'm filming a pilot where we're in pre-production with it. We're not quite done. So, but yeah, no, it's about a group of misfit kids in the 1980s. So looking forward to it.
There's obviously, we talk to people all the time in the show, the writers, filmmakers, producers, directors, and it's always, well, this movie's coming out now. Yeah, well, we made it 8 years ago or sometimes we filmed it during the pandemic, but we're just now are getting out because of all the stuff that had to go through hurdles and everything like that. So it's always a challenge. Sometimes people think, oh, this movie's coming out, it must have just been made. And that's not always the case.
No, not always the case. Yeah. I mean, but we're excited it's happening now because people have been asking about it.
I'm sure.
And where can we see it? When can we see it? And I'm like, now, it's there now.
And it's great local stuff here because St. Louis has so much richness to it. I mean, the different places you shot, like Blueberry Hill, you did the art museum and things like that, and these great places where you can shoot. Talk a little bit about, well, let's start. The idea of this, it's a riff on the importance of being earnest.
Yes.
Because you are a well-read and literary person. You like these kind of things. Talk a little bit about the genesis of the idea for Doubting Tom.
So I played darts at Blueberry Hill. And during the course of darts, you know, all kinds of stories came up, and I was still at Webster University in film school, and you know, so I was thinking about, you know, a romance story because there's a lot of interesting stories. So I was playing with the idea of who you are at Dart League and who you are in your like real life, so to speak, you know, Because I, you know, I was like, people have different personalities in different places. So I was playing with that idea. So I started with the idea of a romance. I wanted to begin with a breakup and follow the trajectory of that breakup. And as I was writing it, the importance of being earnest popped. I think of it as Oscar Wilde sat on my shoulder and said, "Hey, remember me?"
And that's just kind of where you kind of rolled it from there.
Yeah, exactly. And once I realized I was being heavily influenced by this, I was just like, you know, what would be really fun is to incorporate all of this of Dart League into the importance of being earnest and do a real update of it, because I don't think a modern update has been done of it.
Not that I can think of, no, because we always get different Shakespearean ones that are they're updated and redone and everything like that.
Great fun.
But very rarely do we find some of these other... Pride and Prejudice, Little Women, but even that, there are a lot of times those are set in the times in which it was originally written. We don't get a lot of modern day updates as well.
Yeah.
Which, with all the remakes in Hollywood, you would think it'd be begging for some of these to
Yeah, to and come these up. Are yeah, these are great stories, and they should be retold in fresh ways. And you know, this is what Shakespeare was doing in his time. He was retelling stories. So.
Right. And casting in this, you've got a lot of local people from St. Louis, obviously, because you know a lot of people in St. Louis. You know a lot of actors and everything like that. The leads for this, you got from, I remember you talked about casting these people. You got a lot of video auditions.
Yes.
Before it was cool to be doing video auditions.
Yeah.
Right? Talk a little bit about casting your leads for this one.
So I employed Joni Tackett, who is a local casting director.
Yes.
Yeah, she's wonderful. And actually, she knew the lead, the woman who played the lead, Amy Holland Pinnell. She knew her. And when she read the script, she said, "I really think you should consider this actress. She's perfect." I looked at her reel and almost immediately I was like, this is her. This is she. And then we kind of had to sit on it for a while.
Mm.
And then, you know, Joni finally, you know, sent out the audition request. I was just like, what if she's not free? What if she's doing this? What, you know, I was really, and I auditioned quite a few actresses for it just in case, but I'm telling you, Amy read the part and she was just Gwen immediately.
And her now, I think you said they're married in real life, who played her boyfriend at the time in the movie, Brandon Davis. That's kind of cool that they didn't meet on the set. They knew each other previously. They were already dating, if I remember correctly.
They were.
Okay.
They were
married.
Yeah, they are married now, which is it's great fun. It's a love story and a love story. But I didn't actually know this was her boyfriend who was auditioning. He auditioned for two parts. He auditioned for the lead male, and then he auditioned for the sidekick kind of bad boy part. And he did such a great job that I didn't know where to cast him. And so I kind of, you know, I looked at Joni and I was just like, well, let me just call him back for both roles and have him read for callbacks. And she said, oh, that's Amy's boyfriend. I said, no way. So she kind of snuck it in under the radar on me. But obviously when I read them together, they had such great chemistry.
And it kind of follows, like I said, the story of the importance of being earnest. For those of you who don't know, obviously, this is a story about a man who pretends to be somebody else when he's in the country versus when he's in the city. And he kind of leads this double life.
Yes.
And this kind of takes that same riff with a bit of a twist on it. I don't want to. It's hard to describe the movie without spoiling aspects of it, though, especially the way you've done the movie. I don't want to ruin this for anybody.
Yeah, but it's fun. It's just, it's like that idea. It's mixed up identities. It's
right.
Like when you have, you know, so the main character, Tom, he is Tom at Dart League and he is Frank at work and in his other life. And when his friend finds out that he's Tom, and Tom is sort of this legendary character, he has this whole blog, he has this whole online life, he's sort of larger than life, and everyone that comes in contact with this Tom or reads about him is just like, wow, he's so extraordinary. And, you know, and so he's got this great big following. So when his friend finds out about it, he's like, oh, you know, I'm just going to become Tom now. And so all of these things happen when there's two Toms.
Not a lot of online blogs during Oscar Wilde's time, though. So that's another modern twist to it.
That is true. Like, yeah, in that, you know, I had updated it from a journal.
And with the different places obviously being filmed in St. Louis, Blueberry Hill, parts of it were filmed, but then it was also, I know you guys created a stage to be a stand-in for Blueberry Hill as well.
We did. Yeah. Blueberry Hill was great, and Joe Edwards was fantastic, and he did let us shoot a lot in the restaurant. But, you know, as all of you know, Blueberry Hill has a lot of open hours. So in order to accommodate a film set, what I did was I went down to the Stratford Inn. They have this beautiful ballroom, which they let me use, and I built a set in the ballroom to stand in for the bar at Blueberry Hill.
Which is very cool. I mean, I walked into that thing and it was like, whoa, it's like a regular soundstage. You had the dartboards all set up and everything was, but then you go around the side and it's kind of like one of those things when you see the set of like Full House, you walk around the back. Oh, it's just a bunch of 2x4s probably. It's kind of odd to see that in real life though, where you walk onto the set and it's like, it's Blueberry Hill dart room here. On the backside, it's a ballroom at Stratford Inn. It was very neat.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Yeah, I really had to convince people to do this. I was just like, no, it's totally going to work. But I was marrying the world of theater and film. And I was like, come on, guys, people do this all the time. They're like, well, can't you just find a location? And I was just like, no, this is going to be really cool. Let's do it. And then once we did it, they were just like, oh, this is really cool. And I was like, uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bunch of naysayers. Don't listen to the naysayers.
Yeah.
So this, the film from beginning of the writing phase to the casting to when it was finally wrapped, obviously production just now got it distributed and everything like that, but how long did the total project take for you from editing and everything?
Oh, years.
Yeah.
You're counting from me writing it?
Yeah, from starting writing it to the actual, well, I mean, if you've been writing it for a couple years prior, but then you started casting, it's like, okay, boom, we're rolling with it now. So maybe from casting on would be better.
Okay, so from the time I cast it until the time it was finished was about 2.5 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. And then obviously wrapped in 2016, post-production editing, how long was that
process?
Yeah,
the post-production was a good couple of years. Hmm. I had the score written by Harry Manfredini, who... his wonderful claim to fame is that he wrote the music for Friday the 13th. And I know that seems like an odd kind of mix, but I met Harry in 2010 at a convention called Contamination.
Oh, yeah. It was here in Westport, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was, they have had it here. And they, I actually met him, didn't know who he was, met him in the hallway, because I had written a commercial for the convention. Hmm. And, so they gave me tickets and I was just like, yeah, this is great. Cause I love conventions. And, so there we were in the hallway and we just started joking around. I don't know why. I think we met in an elevator and, Harry Manfredini is so funny. And so we just got to talking. And the thing is I was just finishing up a horror film.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just looking for music. And then he was like, why don't you ask me? And I was like, oh, that's really funny. I was like, because I have low budget money and you obviously, like, you know, probably charge more than that. And he was just like, oh, I don't know, Vanessa, why don't you try me? So we had this long conversation about music. And again, everybody laughed at me. They're like, you're not going to get Harry Manfredini to do music for your movie. And I was like, and I always take that as a watch me.
Right.
So, but what he ended up doing is ended up giving me music that, it was sort of like recycled music, music that he had written for other projects that hadn't gotten used.
Oh, okay.
So, I managed to use really a lot of it on, my horror film. And it was a short horror film that I'd done in 2010. So we just became friends after that. And so fast forward really a couple of years after that, I was having lunch with Harry in Los Angeles. And he read Doubting Tom. And he said, hey, when you're done with this, I want to do the music for it.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, really? But it's a rom-com. He's like, I love rom-coms. I love doing music for rom-coms because I don't get... attention for it. He said, but I do this all the time. And I was like, done. You know, I mean, you don't say no to that.
Right. No, exactly. If someone comes along, especially at that level of talent, and says, let me do the music for you.
Yeah, he's great.
And again, if you're listening, if you've got a question or anything like that, you can certainly give us a text on the KTRS text lines at 84126. We're chatting with local writer, filmmaker, producer, director, yep. Writer, producer, all those things, Vanessa Roman, about her film Doubting Tom, which is available now on streaming. I know it's on Amazon Prime because I already looked it up. Any streaming platform or certain ones? Or
right now it is on Amazon and Vimeo. And it's going to come out on iTunes and Google Play anytime now. They're like working with the 4K version, and they've been a little slower about it, but it's supposed to be anytime now.
Very cool. We are going to talk. You're okay to stick with me for another segment or two?
Sure.
All right. We are talking all things movies here on Geek to Me Radio. I'm your host, James Enstall. We're going to take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
This is Eric Goins, the gambler from DC Stargirl, and you're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
You got to know.
We are back. Geek to Me Radio. Eric Goins, the gambler from Stargirl, making it season 3, premiere August 31st. It's now available if you were checking out on the CW or I believe HBO Max. It's also streaming there if you want to check out Eric Goins making his comeback as the gambler in season 3 of Stargirl. I want to make sure we tell you about our official movie sponsor, Marcus Theaters. MarcusTheaters.com is the website. Locations all over the place. Illinois, Iowa, Minnesota, Missouri, Nebraska, North Dakota, Ohio, Wisconsin, or their affiliates, Movie Tavern in Arkansas, Colorado, Georgia, Kentucky, Louisiana, New York, Pennsylvania, Texas, Virginia, and Wisconsin. If you want to see a movie in the best possible surroundings, you're going to want to go see it at a Marcus Theaters or a Movie Tavern. $5 Family Fun Series, September 10th through the 12th. You can check out movies like Pee-wee's Big Adventure, Bad Guys, The Last Unicorn, which makes me cry from when I was a little kid in the 80s. Great song, too, for that. Paws of Fury, more modern movies like that. Sonic 2 and others. Neverending Story, again, a sad movie from the 80s. It might be a theme there as well. Labor Day weekend, Friday of this week through Monday. Tomorrow, you can get hot dogs for $2.50 at your Marcus Theaters or Movie Tavern. Go check out a movie. If you have not already joined their magical movie rewards program, you get points every time you see a movie. Every time you buy concessions, you get points to where you can use those for future movies and future concessions. Download the app on your smartphone. I was about to pull it up, but I don't have a camera with me today, so you don't care. If you're driving down 270, look to your left. I'm holding up my phone. You can see the Marcus Theaters app. If you're out and about, you can use the app to find the location closest to you. Even order your concessions right there through the app. Have them ready and waiting for you at the theater of your choice for a more contactless experience. Great time to see movies, and there are a lot of great movies out to be seen. So make sure you do it in the best possible surroundings. Marcus Theaters, that website again, MarcusTheaters.com, for the best movie-going experience in the galaxy. We did have Eric Goins coming back from that commercial break. Related to, it's one of those things, it's 5 degrees of Vanessa Roman was the game we're playing tonight.
Yeah, he's my nephew-in-law.
See, look at that. And that's how I was able, because you said, hey, you watched Stargirl? I said, oh, yeah, of course. That's my nephew as the gambler. I was like, you've got to be kidding me. So that's one of the reasons we were able to get Eric Goins on the show. And hopefully we're just chatting off air that we might be able to get him back here before season 3 is over to talk about his enlarged role. He's got a little bit more of a role to play this season, too, I understand.
Yeah, he's rocking it.
Very cool. And he's also, I guess, now going to be in the pilot. I'm not going to say a TV series, but the pilot you shot. We were just, again, chatting off air. Eric was in a scene that I was not in for this pilot that you just got done shooting. So let's say this pilot gets picked up. Is it something you're going to be shooting it in DeSoto, or how will that work?
You know, that's all kind of up in the air right now. So yeah. We'll see. But yeah, no, we shot at the Melba Theater in DeSoto, and it's just a beautiful theater. And the Melba has been around, decades. It's since, I don't know, the 1930s, I think.
Yeah.
And it's family owned, beautiful theater. Because I was doing a scene in the past, I needed something that was, that didn't look modern. And let me tell you, Marcus Theaters is definitely the Cadillac of movie theaters. Absolutely. I love watching movies there. But I couldn't shoot anything there because they weren't around in the 1980s.
That's true. Yeah, I think we had Werenberg's here in the 1980s, obviously, but Marcus has come in and now renovated all those and brought them up to speed.
They're beautiful.
Yeah. Again, this isn't an extended commercial for Marcus by any means, but very nice to hear you say kind words about them as well. Yes, Marcus Theaters is fantastic. So with Doubting Tom, now you've got, this is out on streaming service. We just talked as of August 28th, I believe is the date.
August 26th it came out, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And this is, like I said, you've got a lot of great talent because you know a lot of great people. And so you had a lot of people in this. We've got, now all the names are escaping me. Facts of Life. Julie
Pikarsky.
Thank you. Yeah. I was like, I know I can picture her face and I'm glad I got out Julie. But yeah, she's in this as well.
Yeah. Julie Pikarsky, who was, she was in the Mickey Mouse Club.
Yes.
And she was also in the first couple seasons of the Facts of Life. She's fabulous. She was born and raised in St. Louis, went out to, you know, LA when she was a teen, and she's fantastic, such a sweetheart. So what's great is I was able to cast these people who were like St. Louis natives, but you know, they had been out in the world doing amazing things. The other person I think you're thinking of is Greg Sporlater.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, who I love talking to him because he was in one of my favorite movies, The Rock.
Yeah.
He was one of the bad guys opposite Tony Todd. They were the two kind of rogue captains who worked under Ed Harris. And so I was bugging Greg the whole time. I'm like, so what was Sean Connery like? How's working with Sean Connery? He had great. He was very super nice guy, Greg. Just tell me all sorts of things, like indulged me and humored me and told me his stories about working with Sean Connery and working with Ed Harris and everything like that. Nicolas Cage. But he was super nice guy. And very talented, too.
Very talented. Yeah, I know. And it's so funny because Greg has sort of he's done all kinds of things. He did a guest spot on Friends a long time ago. And yeah, you'll have to catch that. It's really great. But he has, really leaned into his career as a bad guy. Mm-hmm. You know, he's a bad guy in so many things. He's a bad guy. He's such a bad guy in True Blood. And
oh, that's right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So here I cast him as this sweet, loving, like, you know, understanding friend, you know, really cool friend and, you know, really cool boyfriend and all of this. And, you know, he's sort of the logic and the kind-hearted, guy at the bar. And you know, I mean, everybody was just like, are you crazy? But Greg's a bad guy. I was like, come on, man. This is my nod to Joe Edwards. I named the character Joe. You know, I sort of like, he's not Joe Edwards, but he's sort of my appreciation of Joe Edwards. Yeah. As the, you know,
what do you call it, homage.
Yes, it's my homage to Joe Edwards. Yeah.
And with this also, one of your other leads, Brian Daniel Porter, who I work with quite a bit in this one. So funny.
So funny.
He's another California native, if I'm not mistaken, right?
He's actually from Minnesota.
Minnesota, okay.
Yeah, he was in Dear White People.
Okay. Oh, I haven't seen that.
Yeah.
But, all right, I'll definitely check it out. Now
in the movie, not the series.
Okay.
The movie.
Okay.
And he plays this just total elitist jerk, and he's so good, but he's just got such a natural talent for humor. If I waited too long to call cut, Brian was gonna say something hilarious, and a lot of it made it into the film, but I was just like, oh my god, I didn't know you were gonna do that. I'm just trying not to laugh and ruin the take. But yeah, he's so naturally funny. And there was one thing where we looked at him, we're like, okay, I just really feel like we need a button on this. We need something here. You know, I'd like to have something. And I was just like, you know, go ahead, Brian, do your magic. And he just would come up with the funniest lines.
So I love that you're that kind of a director who's not so married to the script. That's like, nope, this is how the scene's written. This is how we're going to perform it. Because a lot of times I feel that spontaneity, that's where some of the best little moments, like you always see those behind the scene when you're watching, like you mentioned, Friends, some of the stuff that they'd come up with spontaneously would actually make it in, because it's like, you know what, that's actually a better line. The writers would sit down and they'd sit on the side of the set and they'd rewrite some stuff. But I think that's one of the things that kind of, it's that spark of creativity that happens in the moment that kind of really makes some scenes pop. And that's the fact that he had that je ne sais quoi was a great addition to the film, obviously.
Every time. And, you know, I love that because, you know, I'm an actor myself. And, I love giving my actors an opportunity to explore. And it's my script. I can change it.
Right, exactly. That's one of the, I guess, perks of being both the director and the writer and everything else on the movie.
It is. Well, you know, it does. It gives me a freedom because then I, you know, when I'm directing somebody else's work, I feel a responsibility to, you know, stay with the work. But this is an original piece, so I have a little bit more freedom to it. So I definitely respect the work of, you know, I mean, obviously, if I'm, you know, directing a Shakespeare play, I'm not going to ad lib. Right. But on this, I was just like, have freedom, have fun, have, you know, have that. And so I would wait a little while, and he came up with some zingers. So, and you know, I love that. It's a comedy. That's what we're supposed to do.
I've ad-libbed in a Shakespeare play once or twice myself, but we'll say that for another time.
Shakespeare.
Being the fact that the first time I met you was actually doing theater. Yeah. You've got that theater sensibility. How does that translate to film? Like, you obviously, it's a slightly different aspect directing a play that you're having on a stage versus a film, but there's a lot of the same sensibilities. Talk a little bit about what you bring from your theater background to directing a film.
Oh, I love theater. It's just my first love. And, you know, in film too. But I think one of the things that theater is just such a training ground for directing, because you have the luxury of time.
Sure.
That don't have in that. So I think what I really learned from theater was the language of actors. So when I'm directing a film scene, I need to help the actor, you know, get to really kind of bring out their best self, you know, and navigate that very quickly in a scene. So that's what theater taught me, is to speak the language of actors.
And I don't want to say there's more room for improv in a movie or television series than there is in a theatrical production. That's not always necessarily the case. If you're doing an original piece, like First Run Theater, when you and I met, that's something that, again, the writer of the play is right there on hand. You can actually ask him.
Right.
When you're doing something, when you're doing The Importance of Being Earnest in a stage play, you can't say, hey, Oscar, is it okay if we read this a little bit different? So there's do you find it personally to be more freeing when you're directing a TV show or a movie versus a play?
I think of it like sort of separate in that way. It's just like what I'm into. I'm very monogamous with what I'm into. So if I'm doing a theatrical production, I'm just all in
right.
that mode. Or, you know, so, you know, what is this? I'm having a romance of whatever I'm working on. So I think, let me see, can you clarify that question a little bit more so I can.
Yeah, just I was wondering, is it more, do you find there being more freedom, I guess, creatively when you're working on a film or a TV project versus when you're working directing a stage play or a straight play?
Actually, I think it's the opposite.
Okay.
I have such time constraints in film.
Okay.
I'm like, we got to make our day. We got to make this, you know, we got to get all of this done. So in theater, we actually have more room to explore, mm-hmm. more room to do things over, more room to really kind of like, you know, find the nuances in there.
And again, if you're listening, we're talking with Vanessa Roman all about the brand new. Well, I keep saying brand new because it's out now.
It's brand new.
It is brand new. It's new to you. That's what I'll say. The NBC used to have that moniker. If you haven't seen it yet, it's new to you. New movie out on streaming. Check it out on Amazon and Vimeo, called Doubting Tom. You'll see a lot of St. Louis locations for those of you who are in St. Louis. Filming on location here in St. Louis, obviously this is something that's done all the time in Atlanta and, you know, Vancouver. With St. Louis, obviously they're not used to a lot of film shoots coming through here. So what were some of the challenges about filming this locally here in town that you had to overcome or that you kind of encountered, I guess?
Actually, people were great. It's great to, I think it's an advantage to shoot in the Midwest as opposed to other places, because people are excited to have you. They don't have this every day. You know, I think, you know, in Los Angeles, they're kind of jaded. They're like, ugh, a movie shoot.
Great,
you know,
Travis,
here they're like,
up on the 305.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But now they're, you know, you're coming into their place. They're excited to have you. They're watching everything that's happening there. You know, so I love that. Whenever, you know, I go in and I was just like, hey, we would love to shoot a scene here. But I try to be really honest with people about what it's going to entail. Mm-hmm. It's going to take a while. It's going to take a long time. This is not going to be something that's going to happen fast. We're going to do a lot of takes, and they were great. I did a lot of locations in the Loop, mm-hmm. and I did Loop Lux Salon. There's a clothing store called Soul and Blues. It's not there anymore, unfortunately, mm-hmm. but they were great. We shot at a restaurant called Melt down on Cherokee. They're not there anymore either. I know. Yeah. I know. But it's one of they
victims of the pandemic, I guess most of these places, like a lot of places were.
I think Melt closed down before the pandemic. Oh, okay. So yeah, no, the owners, they moved to Alabama. So
oh, well, all right,
yeah. Well. So, you know, so that was that. But there was just but what was cool is, you know, I got in a lot of like little privately owned, family owned, you know, they weren't chains. So they had a really interesting look, like little different look. And I was able to sort of like, you know, throw some business to some people in the Loop, because the Loop is such a really interesting area.
Yeah. I mean, it's block by block. You'll see differences in the businesses and in all the different aspects of that area. That's a very unique area. That's, again, it's unique to St. Louis, because there's a lot of places you can go to St. Louis. People have talked about that before, and you can go to the Hill, which is different from the Loop, which is different from, you know, town and country. It's like we've got almost an entire world right here in St. Louis. So I wish more places would, or more projects would shoot here. Just because we've got so much to offer, I think.
We need tax credits.
Yeah. So, Governor, if you're listening, we need some tax credits, please. Look how well Atlanta's doing. I'm just going to say. There are a lot of... It seems like everything, because we used to think of New York and L.A. as the hot spots. Now it's Atlanta and British Columbia, Vancouver.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So just the tag between the tax credits. And again, I think the amount of different places that stand in for other places.
Yeah. And you know, St. Louis has a lot to offer, you know, and we love film. We've got a really good community here, and we'd love to work.
Yeah. And so if you're listening and you have a say in that at all, make sure you vote with your for the projects you want to see like that, would happen. Maybe a governor who's more amenable to those kind of things.
Friendly, yes.
Possible. I'm not that we do politics on this show, obviously. But I'm just saying from a purely selfish standpoint, if I'd like more movie projects to be shot here in St. Louis, darn it.
I would, and I would like to cast James Enstall more often.
Well, see, I'd love to be cast, because I enjoy working too. That's one of the great things about doing these projects. And for some reason, you're a glutton for punishment, because you always seem to have me in your projects.
You are. You're like on speed dial. I'm like, oh, I have this part for James.
I need a real jerk in this scene. So, James, are you busy? We just need to come in and shoot.
That's true. That last one. That's how I sold that last one. I was like, hey, James, would you like to play a real jerk?
Was Greg not available? Because he's normally the bad guy.
I know, right? So, I know. But he couldn't hack it in St. Louis. He had to move back to L.A.
Well, that's it happens to the best of us.
I know.
And with this movie, we talked about the music. We talked about the people who worked on people both from California and locally and everything like that. When you finally got this done, and it's you see it on, like we saw, we talked about, we had a screening at the Tivoli on the big screen. Now you get to see it on Amazon. That's got to make you as a creative person just feel so giddy to see this is something that I wrote, that I directed, that I made, and here it is for everyone to watch now on Amazon. You couldn't do that 5-10 years ago. Have it at streaming in household, just boom.
It's so exciting. Yeah, I mean, it's a whole different world. I mean, I think, you know, it's just like, you know, the best you could hope for is to be at Blockbuster, you know, now it's just like, this is super exciting. Yeah, I'll just like look it up. so I can look at the poster, and I'm gonna be like, wow, this is real.
Well, I know my mom's probably listening, and my mom always asks whenever she knows I'm doing a project, she goes, can I get a copy of that on VHS? I'm like, no one does VHS.
No.
You're hearing it from the director, Mom. It's not available on VHS.
It's not available.
I'm sorry.
No.
We'll set you up on streaming, though.
We will set you up on streaming. But we are hoping, actually, to have a DVD release.
Oh,
eventually.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. And that'll be available for through Amazon as well? Or is it going to be a website? And that's what I should ask you. Is there a website that people can learn more about the movie and visit the movie and things like that at all? Or?
So we're still working on the website.
Okay.
But I have an Inspired Productions Facebook page. And you should go there, and I post what's upcoming and where it's showing and press and information.
Inspired Productions, all one word on Facebook?
No, in two words, Inspired Productions.
Inspired, okay, Productions.
Yep.
Okay. Well, if you're listening to this after the fact, if you scroll down to the bottom of the page, I'll have Joey put a link in the show notes. You can click on that, and it'll take you right to the Facebook page. For other places, if people want to keep up with you online, your own website, are you active on social media like Instagram and Twitter or anything like that at all?
I am on Instagram. I am on Twitter. I'm on Twitter as Inspired Vanessa. And it's V Roman on Instagram.
And you've got, obviously, this is out. It's streaming. We talked about the pilot that you shot. You're working on still, obviously.
Yeah.
What other, do you have any other projects? Or, I mean, it sounds like that's taken up a lot of time working on a pilot you're getting launched off the ground. So is there anything else that's kind of percolating on the stove?
Well, I've always got things percolating. But yeah, I mean, that's just sort of consuming me right now is we're getting the pilot. There's another short film that I'm kind of like got in the works that's in there. It's very different. It's a drama. It's about a family dealing with a parent who has Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we're looking at that. I'm kind of like picking somebody down the line. I'm probably going to shoot that in Atlanta. That's what we're sort of looking at. So,
and with a project like that, if you know you're shooting in Atlanta, do you already have like a location? Do you want locations that like these are the places I want to shoot? Or is it being shot in Atlanta because the production house that you're working with is there? How does that kind of come about and work?
So I collaborated with an actor and director named David Conley a few years ago. He was in a horror film of mine, and he's from St. Louis, and he lives in Atlanta now. And I feel that this is just a good project to take down with them. I have a lot of family in Atlanta, and this is Eric.
Oh, yeah.
Eric and his wife live in Atlanta. And this was something I wanted to take down there. It felt right because I want to collaborate with David Conley on it. Mm-hmm. And so that's kind of like the move and push. And his wife is also an actress, Sharon Conley. And she's been in all kinds of crazy stuff. The Blind Side. And some big stuff. So. But yeah, no, he's just a wonderful collaborator. And so I was interested in working with him. So that's why the push there.
And I love the fact, too, if you've not yet watched Doubting Tom, there's the little 80s nods that you put in that are so fun to catch up, pick up on those. And I think when the line was delivered, I was like, and the person delivering the line hadn't seen the movie. She'd not yet seen Back to the Future.
No, they're... That was so funny. No, I had to explain these references to the actors. Yeah, it was super funny. Yeah, no, I've got a nod to Back to the Future. I've also got a nod to Ghostbusters.
I think which one that was.
It's in there.
Don't tell me because that'll be fun for me to watch now. Because I think I was in the scene when you made the Back to the Future reference.
I think you were in both scenes.
Was I?
Yeah. Well, it wasn't your line, so it may have been shot separately. So.
Okay.
Yeah. But
I'll pick that one up too.
You're going to have to look for that. Yeah, I know. But yeah, no, I had to explain the reference and I was just like, well, hopefully the audience will get it.
Right. I'm sure. Yeah. The actors were younger than I am. So who had to deliver the line. So
they were younger. Yeah. I mean, but you know, I mean, we've got this maybe with Afterlife. You've seen Afterlife.
Oh, yes. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. It's really good.
Yeah. It's brilliant.
Yeah. No, no, Ghostbusters Afterlife.
Oh, I'm sorry.
But yes. Afterlife, also Ricky Gervais, yes.
I thought you meant, yeah, I was thinking the series as soon as you said Afterlife.
So good.
Yes. Oh my gosh. If you haven't seen, again, not that we're plugging Ricky Gervais shows all of a sudden, but yeah, if you haven't seen Afterlife yet, Ricky Gervais, 3 seasons, very quick, absolutely brilliant. You'll be laughing one minute and then crying the next, and that's all I'll say as we turn things back to talking about Doubting Tom.
Oh yeah, but she's so good.
So
yeah.
it was a Ghostbusters Afterlife reference.
Just saying that Ghostbusters Afterlife is out. So Ghostbusters references should, you know, come on.
People. I'm tracking now. It's late. I've been up since like 8 o'clock this morning. It's been awful. But yeah, it's a lot. And those little things too are fun to watch in the film. So if you're a film buff, you'll appreciate this film, Doubting Tom. If you're a literary fan, you'll see the through line from The Importance of Being Earnest, and you'll enjoy this film. If you're a local St. Louis person, you'll be like, oh my gosh, they shot that here. You'll enjoy this film. And there's, you know, a dozen different reasons to enjoy this film. So if you get the chance, like we said, it's on Amazon and Vimeo as of August 26th. So you can check it out there. And then you said it's coming to Google Play and iTunes soon.
Soon, yeah. Yeah, it should be within the next week or so.
Very cool. It's always great to talk to you. And we'll put a link, like I said, to your Facebook page in the show notes. So if you're listening, scroll down, you'll see it there. And we will look forward with bated breath to see what these other projects portend once they're released.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much for being on. Vanessa Roman, I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
When we're going to take another quick commercial break, we're going to come right back chatting with Sean Kanan, talking about his role in the upcoming season of Cobra Kai, his work on soap operas, and more. Stand by.
This is Kevin Conroy, the voice of Batman. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
are back. I want to make sure we tell you about our official comic book sponsor, Bugs Comics and Games. Maybe you are seeing all these new Marvel movies and TV series. You're watching She-Hulk, you're watching Ms. Marvel, and you're like, man, this is based on a comic book. What's it about? So you're new to this, and you want to delve into it? Maybe you're a longtime fan. Maybe you still own the John Byrne run of She-Hulk from the 1980s into the early 90s, and you're like, oh, you know, I remember this series. This was great. Or you kind of want to see what's going on now in the current comic books with She-Hulk, or whatever it is, whatever age you're at, whatever entry level you're trying to get into, go see Larry and Tim out at Bugs Comics and Games. They're on Bryan Road in O'Fallon. You can easily access them from Highway 70 or from the Page extension. And they're always buying comic books. Every time you go out there, they'll have something new. They've got new comic books right off the shelf that are the brand new issues of Batman, She-Hulk, independent titles from all the other lines like Boom and Dynamite and Valiant Comics. And if you're wanting something, he doesn't have it, he'll order it for you. Just say, hey, I'd like to add this to my pull list. And let me tell you about the pull list. With gas prices, with the economy, everyone's looking to save money. Join the Avengers Club at Bugs Comics. You can start saving money on your hobby. You start saving money on the new comics, on the back issues, on the supplies, on the games, on all the supplies he has and things like that. So save some money. That way you don't give up on your hobby. Save some money, and that way you can pay for the extra gas and everything like that. But he's got a lot of great stuff, and if you don't know what you want, talking to Larry is like having your own personal comics concierge. He will tell you, okay, well, what character you like? You like Spider-Man? Okay, cool. Here's these comics that we have in our, $3 for $5 box. A lot of great Spider-Man issues from the 90s. You want something a little more modern? Here's the brand new issue that John Romita and Zeb Wells are doing on Spider-Man. He will tell you exactly what you need, point you in the right direction, and it's great to have someone with that kind of knowledge lead you into the comic books. Maybe your local comic book shop is shut down. Bugs is open for business and ready to help you expand your collection. Check him out on the website, bugscomicsandgames.com, facebook.com/bugscomicsandgames. Give their Facebook page a like. I know they would appreciate that very much. You just heard Kevin Conroy bringing us back. Tomorrow is the 30th anniversary of Batman the Animated Series, September 5th, 1992. And starting next week, we're devoting the rest of September to celebrating Batman the Animated Series. We're going to have interviews with director Dan Reba, artist Rick Burchett, the voice of Ingrid Ulia, who voiced Renee Montoya. And we're going to have interviews with Kevin Conroy and the voice casting person, Andre Romano. We'll have all that for you. So make sure you stay tuned to Geek to Me Radio for the rest of the month. Celebrate Batman the Animated Series. With that, we're going to get to my next interview. Mr. Sean Kanan at Terrific Con was kind enough to give me an interview. We talked a little bit about Cobra Kai and how he hadn't been in the series yet. We talked a little bit about his work in soap operas. We talked about his book and all the other stuff he does. This guy, literally, I don't know when he has time to sleep, but he had a chance to talk to us about it. Here's that interview right now. Talking with Sean Kanan, actor, writer, baseball card collector, philanthropist, all this stuff. You've got like a lot of different hats you wear.
Did you actually go on my IMDb and you saw that it said baseball card collector? That's where you got that from, wasn't it?
Wikipedia, actually.
Wikipedia still has them.
Do you not collect them anymore? Or do you?
Well, I did when I was a kid.
Oh.
Not so much anymore at all, but sure. let's go with that.
See, I'll scratch that off. We won't talk about that anymore.
You caught me by surprise there. Was there a question?
I'm just saying. You wear a lot of hats. You do a lot of stuff. I don't know when you sleep.
I do. You know, I love to stay busy. I love to do different things. I think they satisfy sort of different creative passions that I have. I love acting. I love writing. I'm impassioned with my my new book that I'm working on, which is called Way of the Cobra, Welcome to the Kumite. It's a follow-up to Way of the Cobra. And, I love to keep busy. I mean, I think that's the secret to staying relevant, staying vital, is, staying busy.
And you mentioned Way of the Cobra. You've got your book out.
I do.
Cobra Kai, huge success. Mm-hmm. As far as I remember, you're the only person from the trilogy who hasn't come back into the series yet. Is that something they're saving for a big reveal? Can you say anything?
I can neither confirm nor deny.
All I can say,
I can just tell you that the show comes out September 9th, and it's going to be very exciting.
So have you kept up with the series like from the start? Were you immediately like, I've got to check this out, see what they're doing?
I do. I'm a fan of the show. I think it's terrific. I really do. I think it's amazing how they kind of took this concept and turned it on its head, that possibly, Daniel was the bully and Johnny was the victim. The comic sensibilities that the show has is fantastic. And I think it's interesting to see these characters that are 30-some years older and are now more multidimensional characters than they were in the original films.
And I assure you this isn't going to be just a Cobra Kai Karate Kid interview, but I do want to ask, I remember watching you in that movie. You terrified me. That intense look in your eyes, where do you go to as an actor in your headspace for that kind of energy?
Well, you know, first of all, that guy would have scared the crap out of me when I was 17 or any other age anyway. You know, I don't know. You know, it was fun at the final tournament scene. They really allowed me the latitude to do a lot of ad-libbing and to just kind of go for it. And, you know, I was bullied a lot as a kid. And I think, thank God I never had a bully like Mike Barnes. But I suppose on some level it was a bit of an amalgamation of, you know, certain characters that I encountered, you know, when I was a kid. Probably a little bit of Mr. T from Rocky III and I don't know what else.
A little clever line.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
And then shifting gears to AJ Quatermain, doing soap operas and things like that. I've been told from people who have done both genres that soap opera acting is a notch harder than anything else. You've got all the lines to memorize. You're doing a little bit more reaching for certain character aspects, and there's different writers involved. Talk a little bit about working on General Hospital.
Well, I'm currently on The Bold and the Beautiful for CBS.
Sure,
But, you know, the same thing really applies. It's not any different working in daytime. You know, every single medium has different challenges and has different things that are great about it. Soap operas move at an incredibly fast pace. A lot of people don't realize we do about 1.5 to 1.75 shows a day because we have to bank shows. You know, we just, for instance, this month, July, we're off all month. Well, we got to have shows for next July.
Right.
So there's a lot of dialogue to learn. You're making emotional choices very quickly. And it is a bit like an assembly line in the sense that, you know, a certain amount of product has to be turned out every week.
Yeah.
And that necessitates working at a certain clip. You know, within that, you're trying to do the very best work that you can do. But, you know, there are constraints. One of the things I like the most about doing a film, you know, you may only shoot 4, 5, 6 pages a day.
Right.
And on an average day in on The Bold and Beautiful, we may shoot 80 pages.
Man.
It's a lot.
And so do you have one of the characters that resonates more with you, Deacon versus AJ? Is there more of you in one of those characters?
That's a tough one. You know, look, I suppose there's aspects of me in both of them. I really love playing Deacon Sharp. I had a lot of great memories playing AJ Quatermain, but Deacon Sharp, I think, really has been one of the defining roles that I've had in television.
And we've had Eric Braeden on the show probably about a year ago. Just the gravitas of the man, I would almost be intimidated to work opposite with him. How is he to work with?
I adore Eric. You know, when I was on Young and the Restless, I had always told myself, if I ever got a chance to work with Eric, I had to take a second and literally kind of pinch myself and realize that I was working with the best of the best. But that being said, you know, when you're working opposite anyone, you need to deal with them as the character, not as anybody who's fanboying.
Sure.
And as much as I love and respect Eric, he would expect nothing less than me bringing 100%. And that's also what makes him so good. You know, I mean, he kind of doesn't ask any quarter and doesn't give any.
Do you have, whether you're doing film versus television versus soap opera, is there something you've learned along the way that's helped you in any of those areas more than another?
I think the single biggest thing that I've learned is the ability to do a little bit of very quick writing and have the ability to change some lines if they're not working. Is incredibly valuable. You know, there are times that you just need to tweak something just a little bit and it makes all the difference in the scene.
Yeah.
And, you know, as a guy that's a writer, I'm always trying to think of, you know, one if not several options that I could use for a line that might be scripted. And fortunately, I work in a situation on Bold and the Beautiful where they're incredibly giving in allowing me a little bit of latitude to put my own personal stamp on the role. And I think that's part of what's allowed the character of Deacon to be so successful is that I can if something isn't working, I'm able to kind of get in there and you know, make the words flow a little better for me personally.
And improv, you mentioned that some of these places
absolutely
give you the ability to that. I love improv as an actor.
Absolutely.
Most actors do.
Yeah.
It's just that ability to find the character more.
Yeah, it's critical. You know, I do stand-up comedy. I think I've studied improv at Second City. And I think the ability to do some improv is critical. You know, in soap operas, we don't see a lot of humor. And for me, I'm always trying to insinuate humor into it because human beings use humor all the time.
Yeah.
We use it when we're happy. We use it when we're sad. We use it when we're scared. And you don't see a lot of that in daytime. And so I'm always trying to find the moments of funny when I can do that. And I think my background in stand-up comedy and improv really helps with that.
With stand-up comedy, is that something you just, is it your cathartic outlet? You do the acting, you do the filming, but then this is where you get to kind of let loose a little bit more when you do the stand-up?
You know, I think the thing that I like about stand-up comedy is the fact that it's in front of a live audience. You get that instant reciprocity.
Yeah. Like theater.
Exactly, like theater, which is, you know, theater and stand-up, probably what I love, probably the most fun. You know, I love film, for instance, because whether it's a piece of garbage or it's a great film, it's a part of the cinematic tapestry in perpetuity. It's there forever, right? Television is disposable, although now you could argue that with the internet, it's archived somewhere.
Sure, yeah.
But a film's a film, right? But with a film, you're generally shooting, you know, out of sequence. The hours are long. With stand-up comedy, it's like it's you and your words, man. It's sink or swim.
Right.
And you know if it's working and you know if it's not. And it's kind of the same thing with theater. So like I said, there's, you know, bringing it all the way around, different mediums have different things that are, you know, I don't want to say pluses and minuses, but things I tend to like more about.
Of course. And I know I don't want to keep you too much longer. I've just got a minute or so left. I was going to ask you, when you're doing all these things, you're writing, you're cooking, you're doing stand-up, do you accept, take certain parts of your time out of your day to, like, you organize, like, I'm going to set aside this time for writing, I'm going to set aside this time to work on my stand-up, I'm going to set aside this time to learn my lines?
I wish I was quite that disciplined. I'm not. I do chunk my time. I tend to get up very early, like around 5:30 in the morning.
Wow.
I get a lot of work done before the rest of the world wakes up. I think it's an amazing time. I talk about this in my book. You know, if you can shut out the chaos of the outside world, do a little meditating, silence the monkey chatter, set your intention and vision for the day, it'll change the trajectory of the day. You know, I'm fortunate that I've got a lot of structure in my day because, you know, when I'm filming, that's what I'm doing during the day. It's on the days when I don't, when I have to build the structure in. But trying to make sure I get a little bit of everything done.
And if people want to get the book, if you're listening right now, we will have a link to it in the show notes at the bottom. Amazon, the best way to do it?
It's on Amazon and Kindle, or if you'd like to get a signed copy, you can get it at wayofthecobra.com.
And social media handles, how can people get up and keep up with you?
On Instagram, it's sean.kanan and at seankanan on Twitter.
Sean Kanan, it's been a blast. Thanks so much for your time today.
I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Make sure you're checking out Cobra Kai Season 5 when it returns on September the 9th. My thanks again to Sean Kanan for the interview. I want to make sure before we get out of here, we tell you about our premier sponsor, the City of St. Charles, the Greater St. Charles Convention and Visitors Bureau. Longtime listeners will know the website by heart, discoverstcharles.com. And of course, if you want to go out there, have some fun in these waning days of summer as we head into fall season, we're in September here. It's not going to be long before the leaves start falling and the seasons start changing. Get out and bike ride the Katy Trail, play some Frisbee in Frontier Park. Eat outdoors on the patio at Salt and Smoke. Lots of enjoyment still to be had, and the City of St. Charles offers a lot of great places to enjoy these waning days of summer. Fall is right around the corner, so their big Legends and Lanterns Festival will be gearing up. You can get out there and have some Halloween fun the last three weekends of October. Always something going on, always some fun to be had. Start your trip, whether you're here locally or from out of town, at the website discoverstcharles.com. That's discoverstcharles.com. For an historically good time. My thanks again to my guest, Vanessa Roman, talking about Doubting Tom. Check that out on your streaming platform of choice. Thank you to Sean Kanan, and thank you to all of you for listening. Until next week, my friends.
Make Game of Thrones references. That's a show.
Hey, kids, are your parents about to buy you a shiny new toy from Amazon?
Hi, I'm Chucky. Wanna play?
Well, don't be selfish. Share some of that money with us. Before going on Amazon, make sure to type in bit.ly/geektome in the web browser. It will look just like Amazon.com, except it'll say referral Geek to Me Radio up top. And then when you check out, a tiny percentage will go to support the show without costing you 1 cent more. So before your parents get you that gizmo, gadget, or widget, make sure they type in bit.ly/geektome in the web browser.
bit.ly/geektome, bit.ly/geektome.